Good morning, sports fans. Welcome to the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM, streaming live on the web at WLCNonline.com. I'm Scott Kirby along with Joe Ryan, and we are at Joe Ryan Country Financial.
There you go. You can read it right there. We put those up for you.
I forgot.
Oh, right in front of you. All you got to do is look at Lloyd.
Well, yeah, I try not to do that. We are at Joe's. So thanks for having us today, Joe, on this nice snowy morning.
I got up early. I turned the heat on. I shoveled some snow. I got some coffee going. This place is all ready to go.
It's ready to go.
All ready to go.
You did shovel some snow out there. Hey, there
I'm
he is.
Taking care of business.
Coach out right
well,
on.
Well, here he comes. Look, would you go back and then come through like you're coming out through the regular thing? Just bust through to come out. We'll play a little. Well, I'll dim the lights. Don't trip and fall.
Yeah, because we'll sue you for everything you have.
Well, they won't get much. You'll be at work Monday.
Good morning, Coach.
Good morning. Been shoveling a little snow.
Yeah, me too. I wasn't late, though.
Yeah.
Well, he's got a little bigger driveway than I
do. How about you guys would make the wives do that?
Yeah. Do you?
No. He doesn't even shovel his, so.
It'll melt eventually.
Yeah.
It goes like rain, only different.
Yeah, yeah. Good game last night, Coach. Got off to an early lead, a big lead. Eisenhower, they've been playing some good basketball of late, but Lincoln comes out and don't know who that is. Somebody from Vermont wanting to talk to me.
We were going to dance.
Yeah. But Eisenhower, they've been playing pretty good basketball of late. Come in last night, and Railers come out, and they do what they do. We hit some three-pointers, at the beginning of the game to kind of get the flow and kind of get in a rhythm. And, from there on, it was just all Lincoln all night.
Well, we talked about it on the post game last night a little bit about Coach Ewall works with our zone an awful lot, and he spends a lot of time finding holes and things. And, we have a staple here at Lincoln that our 1-2-2 is, what we do. And I think Coach Walker is trying to find a defense, and I believe it's been a 1-3-1 for most part, and we've been able to get him out of that 1-3-1. And when you force somebody to go to a secondary defense that they probably don't work on a whole lot, you're in a world of hurt. So that's why we play one defense. We may look bad at times, but it's the only thing that we know how to do, and we're better off being bad at our defense than trying to do a secondary defense and not have a clue on really what we're doing. So we're a hard team to zone. Our kids understand. They're unselfish. They move the basketball. They find the open man. And they really make things happen. And we got them right out of that zone real quick. And we shot the ball pretty well last night. So it was what we call a trap game. Because we handled them the first time really easy, and then coming off the Lanphier game that we had Tuesday night of an overtime game, you just don't know how the kids are going to respond. And I thought our kids come out and played pretty well last night.
Looked like they had a lot of energy last night, Coach, especially in the third quarter. You kind of like to see we're a little running and gunning, a lot of transition up and down the court. It's not a style of Railer basketball we're accustomed to, but to see that, if they need to push the ball up the court, make that extra pass. It was kind of fun to watch there for a while. The game was kind of a snoozer. I'd prefer those in a close one, though. But the kids are out running. They had a lot of energy. Now how are they going to react tonight?
And I'm gonna go against you guys there a minute. I like the games where we're down by 14 in the third quarter. That I'm a fan. That's a little more excitement for me. But go ahead. I didn't want to interrupt you guys.
I tell you what, that ain't very on an old man. That's kind of tough on the old ticker.
Hey, I was wondering about you, to tell you the truth. We had paramedics standing by.
Joe had the defibrillator in hand.
I wanted to do it anyway for you.
Yeah, do it when I don't need it.
But, you're going to have a little shoot around today at 10 o'clock and get ready for, got three games tonight.
Yeah, we really got more than that. We've got our freshman tournament that starts here at 10 o'clock. I know they're hard over in the parking lot trying to get the snow off, but I have not heard anything. As far as I know, the tournament's still on. And,
how many games will Lincoln play?
Lincoln's
today,
freshmen
there.
Will play two games today.
Today.
They'll play at 10 o'clock in the tournament. They play Dunlap at 10 o'clock, and then they turn around and play Joliet Central at 4 o'clock.
Gotcha.
So there'll be, four games in the tournament. We run both gyms. We use both gyms, and we'll play at 10, and 11:30, and then they'll be done around 1, and then we'll start again at 4 with the freshmen, and our sophomores will play at 5:30, and then the varsity around 7. So
that's kind of a neat concept. You see maybe doing a little bit more of that in the future? Well, or is that just too long of a day for...
Well, if you didn't have the freshman tournament this morning, it would be okay, but you're still dealing with a lot of kids playing on different levels. Yeah. And, you know, when our enrollments keeps continue to drop, you know, you have to use a freshman on the sophomore team. Some, you know, you fill your varsity roster, you know, to develop the future of the program. And, but, you know, we got those kids playing so many games. But, yeah, it's a pretty good philosophy, and I believe we're planning on doing that when we go up there next year.
Oh, so we do go there next year.
Wow. So I like back up a second because I'm a dumb football coach. When you spoke earlier about the your offense, what ultimately are you looking to do to that defense? As far as like when you get in the game, is there a certain point in time where they pop into a 2-3? Are they popping that zone? That's where you know you're going to work best. That's when your offense works the best. Is there a certain one?
The defense or offense is really 3 out with 2 inside, with Gavin have the option to step out, and then we're 4 around 1. And you know, it's
understanding.
I got that. I can count all the way up to 10.
And the thing is, Gavin just gives us, he's a nightmare of a matchup because he can step out and he sees over things. You know, you take our younger kids that are really small, they can't see over and out of those traps. But you try and trap Gavin and he's just standing up there kind of grinning at you, and he's just kind of picking them apart. But, you know, we got different things that we want to do. The one goal is we try to get the ball to the baseline to flatten the zone, and then you got all the room in the world to work. You get it inside, you've got the guy on the baseline. You get it to the baseline, you got the guy on the high post. You get it in the middle. You got 3 options. You got the 2 guys stepping to the corner. You got the guy running the baseline, and you try to overload where their people's at in the zone. And our guys do a great job of ball movement. And you know, I thought Peyton Ebeler had a really great game last night.
Sure did.
He got inside of them, and when he penetrates, he may not score a point, but whenever he gets inside, he just creates so much for our offense, and you know, he opens up lanes that the kids don't have.
Yeah, it was a good game last night.
It was.
Is it the most difficult than a man?
Well, we don't
give you more problems.
No, not really. We I don't know if you. Last night, Jordan Perry hit a 3, and again, it's going back to the football days when I coached football. You always had a counter for an offensive play, and you come back with a counter to it. And, you know, we run some counters last night, and I don't know if you remember the situation, but Jordan Perry hit a 3, and the very next time, we run the same play, but we slip the pick, and Aaron Hopp scores a wide open layup because they're jumping out to cover Jordan Perry. So, you know, it's kind of a chess game, and when your offense is working, it's a lot of fun to look out there and call the different sets.
Let's talk a little bit about Aaron Hopp. He plays like he's about 6'7", 6'8". I didn't know he could jump like that. He's just an overall athlete. And that's got to be kind of, you know, going into the season, kind of not sure where he kind of stands, being so small. But he's, you know, only how tall is he? Maybe 6 foot?
Maybe
6 foot.
That's really taking him in. I mean, you're pulling him hard.
I mean, he's down there. He's jumping with those big guys. And more times than not, he's coming out of there with a rebound or a putback.
Well, we knew going into the year that where Aaron was going to play. He was going to play and be one of our backs. And we also knew offensively he was going to be a nightmare, just like Gavin's a matchup. There's no post player that can cover Aaron Hopp defensively one-on-one. So, if, you know, when he starts going to the basket, it's basically a guard on a post man. And he can also shoot it. So when they decide, well, they're beating me to the basket, now he backs off, we'd like to see Aaron maybe shoot the ball a little bit more when they don't cover him. But again, he's so unselfish, he keeps moving the ball and creating a lot of things for us. But the worry that we had coming in was, you know, the bigger teams deciding to go inside and post with him being inside. But for the most part, we've done a good job keeping pressure on the ball and not allow him to really pick us apart
inside.
And
he gets up quick.
He's quick off the floor.
Yeah, he gets
he's just
up
a good
quick.
Athlete.
Yeah,
he's got a lot of athletic ability, and you know, he's fun to coach.
Coach, we got Joliet Central tonight. Southeast beats Chatham last night. So right now, Lincoln atop of the Central State 8. So the conference championships are in our hands right now. We just have to finish out the season strong.
Well, tonight's a non-conference game, which right. It doesn't affect our standings. But, you know, we're getting down to where we want to be on a roll, being running, being consistent here, going into the state tournament, which starts a week from Monday. Can you believe that? A week from Monday, another year, another postseason. And, you know, we want to be consistent on what we're doing, execution, and you know, being to that point. Joliet Central, as you know, my whole complaints with the IHSA is they basically run two separate tournaments. When we get there, the downstate, half the schools are put into anywhere from four, five, six teams in a little pod. They already assign you to a regional, and then there's the other half that's the suburban and Chicago schools. They get put into they take their four regionals that feed into a sectional, and they seed all them 1 to 20, 1 to 21, 22 teams, and then the one plays 22 and right on down, the way it should be, the way it used to be. But Joliet Central, out of I think it's a 22 team sectional complex, they're ranked seventh. So it'll be a chore. They're not very big. They're quick. They do a lot of different things. They're going to 2-2-1. They're going to 1-2-2. They're going to man. They're going to play half court, press, traps. So it'll be a lot of variation of defenses tonight. So we have to be able to pick up on them and be able to attack. And, again, if we shoot the ball like we capable of shooting it, we should have some fun tonight. But again, and it all comes down to the mental preparation. One good thing about last night, we got a lot of kids off the court, so we're playing back-to-back right. games. Shouldn't be any, shouldn't be a problem today, this game. So, and this is the last game this year that we'll ever play back-to-back. So, you know, hopefully we can get through that. Chatham went to Southeast last night and got beat. We have to go to Southeast Tuesday night. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Southeast is playing very well. They've had a couple kids that have been dismissed from their team. And, I think they're just finding themselves again. And Coach Thomas is a great coach. He can play you any way you want to play. If you want to play up-tempo, he'll play up-tempo. If you want to play a half-court game, and that's what makes that a tough matchup for us, because we want to control and play a half-court game. Well, he can match us as well. So,
is a big surprise to me last night was the Rochester over Lanphier. That surprised you or no?
Yeah, it really kind of, and it was at Lanphier, and I thought that Lanphier. I don't know which way they're going. I thought after did we knock the wind out of the sail Tuesday night? They're seeded one in their regional, and I really don't know if they'll come out of there. I think there's some teams. Southeast was seeded fifth, and I think Southeast has as good a chance as anyone coming out of there. So, we just we got to take care of our business and run into. I would like and hope that I think it's a great thing if we end up with three schools from our conference in the sectional tournament, and that's a very strong possibility.
You know, Tuesday night's game was fun. Like I said, you know, you're down 14. That's fun. We didn't talk too much about it, but I thought the turning point or the fun point of the game was we hit something. Obviously, Will Cook's bomb from three-point land. I don't know. I think he was down the hallway. That was a bomb. That obviously was a big shot, but we got the game to within eight, and they called a timeout. And when we went to the sides, our fans, our pep section started jumping up and down saying, we think we're going to win the game. That one chant they do. And it was cool because I could see the Lanphier kids kind of got over to the huddle and were turned around looking at them like, you know, what's going on? They're going to win the game. Well, then, and then we did. You know, yeah. It was fun.
A play that stands out in my mind was we're down by 13 or so, and Perry had that look, just that mad look. He's looking over at Coach on three. Three. Well, you called the play, and sure enough, he goes in that corner, and I think the ball almost hit the ceiling. That's how much arch he had on it. Nails it. And then I think, and then just from there, you know, the kid just kind of got some energy, and before you know it.
Well, that's when we, you know, he hit that one, and we called the same play again, and then we slipped Aaron to the basket. Yeah. So, yeah. You know, and one play can set up another, and, you know, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was yeah fun see, game. I think you should spot all those teams. Maybe not 14. 12?
I'm 16. I'm getting up there in age.
Let's
though.
Just get out by 20 and, you know, coast.
I saw you last night all relaxed down there on the bench, right. Relaxed. You know, that's not what we go for. We go for the excitement.
Joe.
Okay, Joe.
Okay, that's all right.
Well, Coach, thanks for coming in today. The next time we talk to you, the regular season will be over, and we'll be getting ready for state tournament play over in Mount Zion. We'll play Tuesday.
Yeah, next Tuesday. They're playing both the semifinal games on Tuesday night, so we'll play at 6 o'clock against the winner of the Paris-Mount Zion game. So that will, you know, Tuesday night, that'll be an early start, which is good. The kids will get home early, and the only thing that the disadvantage to doing them in the same night, you get a number one seed for a reason, and that's you know, you play on Tuesday and the second seed plays Wednesday, so that's a negative thing about playing them on two nights if you're the number one seed. If you're the number two seed, it's a great great alignment.
Yeah, well, that's your favor then more, I guess. Well,
didn't you change that?
I can't change it, but I bet you can.
No, the whole school has the option to do that if they feel like.
Oh, really?
Yes, you know, and you know, if you remember back a lot of years ago when we were going to the sectional at the Prairie Convention Center, they always played the semis on the Tuesday night, both of them. But that's a big enough place to really hold. And you know, I would be a little worried at Mount Zion that you got you know, Lincoln playing Mount Zion will be a good draw, mm-hmm. And then you got Eisenhower and MacArthur playing. So you know.
At least we get in and get our seats first.
That's right. And
yeah, if you get off negative, work early enough.
The negative thing for them is, you know, they're only going to make, gate-wise, there's no Wednesday night
true.
Gate. So, you know, you get, well, I don't know what it is now for a regional. Is
$5.
Is it $5? For a regional, you get to see both games.
Yeah.
That's a good deal.
Yeah.
$5.
And it only takes you up one night. So there you go, Joe.
Two for one. I'm all about that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We got gifts. We got prizes we give away on here.
We do.
We'll have to get to that.
Yeah. Lincoln Speedway tickets to give away. Stay tuned. We'll have a question for that. I don't know when the races start. I think Jim said tonight there's a race. Put on them snow tires and go. But, Coach, thanks for stopping in once again. And we will talk to you next Saturday as the Lincoln Railers finish up the regular season and head into tournament play. So stay tuned. You're in the cheap seats on 96.3
FM. I think you've been to a movie recently. You see the way he moved around on that? Holy cow.
Very smooth.
You know what? It looked like you had 49, 50 moves on that.
That's all you need. And a couple little head bobs and a shoulder shrug.
And you're wearing gray.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I got several shades of gray on.
Hey, we're back live here, 96.3.
We are
Saturday morning sports show.
And where are we at?
And we're at Joe Ryan Country Financial for all your insurance needs. See Joe Ryan. That was pretty good, huh?
What are your feelings about Joe Ryan? How do you?
I really like him. You know what? He's intelligent. Just you know what? Just a well-rounded athlete.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Stays in great shape. I think he's going with Kurt Courtright to do some of those races. I think what are those called? Those tough guys. Mudders.
Tough mudders.
I think he's going to do some of those. So, is that? Can you speak in a third person on here? No, not sure. Maybe you can. Hey, I got to read a letter here real quick. This was Dear Mr. Ash. This letter is to say thank you to Scott Kirby for all of his hard work and dedication to the Junior Railer basketball program. His countless hours, along with those of the coaches he puts in place, are shown in the safe and learning environment provided to our kids. He enlists the help of the top LCHS players and students who willingly give their time on Saturday mornings to serve as positive role models, and this is much needed at this day and age. He orchestrates for these future stars the opportunity to play at Roy S. Anderson Gymnasium in front of the Railer Nation. You could have said it with me.
I didn't know where you were going.
What an exciting experience for these kids and the beginning of the dream of the future. Thank you again for your continued dedication to keep this program going and for a great 2014-15 season. And that is from the 2014-15 Junior Railer coaches, players, and their families.
All of them?
Yep.
Really?
Like, you stand up now, and, well, they can't see you, so forget it. So. And there's really no award. There's no... You're not getting any monetary things.
That's all I need.
You're not getting anything, but they do appreciate what you've got going on there.
Well, thanks. You know, one good compliment is
it's good all you enough need.
Because there's a whole lot of not so good compliments that I get. So, well, thank you.
Hey, anytime you get involved, you're going to have people.
Yeah, you can't please
don't
everybody.
Like it. That's and exactly right.
You know, this program's it's nothing that I'm doing out there that hasn't been done for years and years. You know, it's the same program that I don't know who started it, you know?
I would guess Lauren Wallace at some point.
No, it was some, I can't remember the guy's name, but it's been the same and. There's been many people that do it, and as soon as I can find somebody to take it over for me.
How long have you been doing it?
Oh, boy, how long have I been doing it? A long, long time.
A long time?
Yeah.
And just wondering.
Yeah.
It's aged you, I think.
It has aged me, and yeah.
It has helped keep weight off of you, though. I know that.
Yeah, it has. It's
working around all of it, doing stuff.
You can barely see me here. Hey, WLCN 96.3 FM and Jake's Furnishings in Lincoln are in WLCNonline.com are proud to once again sponsor the Lincoln Railer Basketball Cheerleaders Mega Furniture Raffle. It's going on now. Each ticket is $5 or 5 tickets for $20, and you can win a top quality Italia Presidential Collection, 100% leather, valued at $3,500. This is going to be given away at Jake's, located 1100 Woodlawn. Yep.
Yeah.
And you need not to be present to win. You can purchase your tickets from the junior varsity or varsity cheerleaders, and all proceeds will benefit the cheerleader summer camp and uniform expenses. So you've only got another, what, two home games? The drawing's going to be next Friday?
Yeah, it looks pretty nice.
Yeah.
I'd like to win it.
I would too.
And we are eligible.
We are eligible.
Put the name in there.
I will be buying a ticket tonight, so look me up.
We certainly will. And this just in, did Gordy Joshman start that program?
I don't know. That just came in.
A text I received. I don't know if that's true or not true. We do have our new head football coach is going to be coming in. Do we want to take a commercial and get him in here and get set up, or just walk him on in like he's busting through the Railer thing?
What do you say, Jim? You're our producer. Let's take a commercial. Jim says take a commercial because without them commercials, this highly intelligent broadcast
this show
would not be
doesn't
possible.
Go on.
So stay tuned. When we come back, we'll have your new Lincoln Railer football coach, Seth Bass, in with us. So stay tuned. You're in the cheap seats on 96.3 FM.
Wish that I was on a rocky top.
What is that?
Tennessee.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
See, you don't like that.
You never know, though. Hats off to Jimmy. Gave it a shot. You know, he tried something. He got out on the edge. Maybe he slipped and fell. I don't know, but he got out on the edge.
I don't ever play that again.
Got out on the edge. Nice job, Jim.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Cheap Seats on 96.3 FM and streaming live on the web at WLCNonline.com. And for those of you not around a computer or a radio, download the what is that? Tune in app, and you can listen to this highly rated
recognized show
wherever you want.
It doesn't help you for basketball games because there's too much of a delay if you're at the game.
Well, I've been trying to put the headphones to it if you're at the game.
Oh, there's nothing better than having the headphones on and watching the game at the game, but it's too much of a delay.
I wonder why you're always 7 seconds behind.
I'm slow. I've never said that.
All right.
I wasn't.
We do have the new football coach at Lincoln High School with us this morning, Seth Bass. Good morning, Seth.
Good morning.
Thanks for coming in. Just a little bit of a bio on you. Bass was an assistant coach last season at Herman, Missouri High School, which went 9-3 and finished second in the Class 2 District 5 Championship. Mr. Bass is a native to Cooksville, Tennessee, and taught history and psychology at Herman High, in addition to serving as an assistant track and football coach. He has also been AD at McLean Christian Academy in Lebanon, Tennessee, while coaching football, volleyball, bowling, and golf, and assistant football coach at Culver Stockton College in Missouri from 2006 to 2009, and football assistant at Cumberland University in 2010. Coach, looks like a pretty long bio right there. You can't be very old. So
pretty well-rounded. Yeah.
Not terribly old.
Yeah.
Feeling older every day, though.
Well, it's going to even get worse. Look at this guy.
Look, gray hair I've got. I'm only 25.
Well, I would like to thank you for coming in with us today, and welcome to Lincoln. Pretty good buzz going around Lincoln right now, believe it or not.
That's what I've heard.
You've been told, Lincoln's been kind of, I don't know, sanctioned as a basketball town, but there are several football people in this town just itching. I mean, just biting at the bit for a good football team, a good football season, a good football program. So, you know, from the things I've heard, you're ready to jump in both feet and let's get this thing going.
Definitely, definitely.
Coach, I'll start, just a few questions for our listeners so they'll know some stuff out there about you. You know, with your background and you're an outsider of the community and with all the opportunities out there, what made you choose to come to Lincoln?
Well, you know, I really believe that this is where God wants me right now. You know, it's with my background and my upbringing. I grew up a Vanderbilt fan, which is why the choice for Rocky Top wasn't the best selection there.
He may have done that on purpose.
He might have.
Keep your eye on him.
Might have been a little backhanded.
So, you keep your eye on him.
That was that's the official University of Tennessee song. So we don't want to hear that.
I don't think Jim really knew that, did you?
Oh, he knew.
Oh, okay. He's a clever little guy.
But you know, growing up a Vanderbilt fan, and that really had a big influence on my interest in coaching. You know, growing up the first 26 years of my life without seeing them have a winning record, and you know, I'm 32 now and I've only seen it three times, so you know, I can relate to the fans and the community supporters here that are, they're just dying to see a winner, and you know, that's, like I said, it's influenced my coaching background and the stops that I've had. You know, Culver Stockton was a rebuilding situation, wanted to really help turn that around. Went to Cumberland University, came in on the tail end of that rebuild and was there for their breakout season. Went to McLean Christian. That wasn't so much a rebuild, but just a original build. You know, they'd played 1 year of football and had a middle school team, and I had transitioned them to varsity. And then once we merged into a co-op there, I stayed on for my kids, and I was good friends with the team, the head coach of the team that we merged with, and we wanted to break through there. They were kind of a perennial losing program too, and we were able to set a whole bunch of records defensively that year. I know he set some records offensively, and we tied the school record for wins, which was awesome. And then Herman, you know, that was I came in on the back end of that rebuild as well. Coach Emmons has done an awesome job down there. You know, it's a great staff, a bunch of great guys, and you know, in 3 years, he inherited a 1-9 program and went 4-5. 6-5 last year, and then we broke through with 9-3 this year, and I expect them to be as good or better next year. So it's been a big part of my career, and to see this opportunity and to see that this is the pure definition of a rebuild. You know, we're going to take the attitude that this is going to be, we're going to push the reset button on this program and basically almost start from scratch. You know, we're going to tear down everything that we can and build it back up. That doesn't mean that we'll eliminate everything, but we'll probably change just about everything.
But you know, that's the greatest part about that is you've been in the rebuilding aspect of that 2, 3, 4 times all during your career, which is what you're going to have to go on here. So
absolutely,
that should help. You know, so you've had coaching experience at the collegiate level, at the high school level, all the different sports. So you're obviously very well rounded. Is that background you feel really going to prepare you for this?
Absolutely. You know, at McLean Christian, I was very fortunate. I had a great deal of responsibility there as an athletic director. We didn't have a whole lot of facilities because of the size of school we were. So, you know, we had to use other people's gyms. And for our football program, we had to use some community fields and those type of things. So, you know, I was stretched out quite a bit. And I was used to, you know, working with maybe not having everything. So, you know, that's going to prepare me. It sounds like we've got just about everything we need here at Lincoln from talking with Sam and some of the other coaches so far. So that's a very good thing. I really think, too, you know, with I was very fortunate in my collegiate background to, in my 5 years as a collegiate assistant, you know, I got to be part of four offenses. So I got to learn a great deal there. But at the same time, just because of the way it timed out, I actually spent 3 years in the same offense. So, you know, I've got a very good grasp of game planning. You know, Culver Stockton at the time I was there, I know it's changed since then, but at the time I was there, we were very behind the curve as far as scholarships we could give. So we were kind of playing behind from a talent level aspect, and that really teaches you a lot of lessons as far as game planning and how to prepare and how to make yourself, you know, be competitive and give yourself a shot from week to week. So I think that'll help me a lot going into this season. I really think that the kids will buy into the plans that we've got in place. I think the coaches will buy in. I think the parents and the community, once they see what we're doing, you know, no one's comfortable with change. It's just human nature. But I think once they, if they'll give it a chance and see what we're going to do and see the positive things that start happening, I think they'll be very on board with it.
Coach, some of the questions that, you know, you're obviously going to have, and just kind of explain the best you can. Questions I've been getting the past week, and any new head coach that comes into a new program, they want to know, what's your football philosophy? What type of offense do you believe in? Are you an offensive guy or a defensive guy?
Most of my background is on the offensive side. I spent the last 2 years on the defensive side as a coordinator with the co-op, and then this past year with defensive backs and kind of an unofficial co-coordinator somewhat at Herman. You know, I had a lot of input with the game plan and everything, so that was, you know, that was awesome. But I would say I'm an offensive guy. You know, my offensive philosophy, it's really going to be, we're going to go with what works. You know, if we're able to run the ball, which we need to be able to run the ball, you don't win consistently without being able to run the football. So we will run first, but we're not going to run exclusively by any means. You know, we will throw the ball around. I'm going to say that we're going to be balanced. That doesn't mean we're going to be 50-50. That doesn't mean we're going to be 60-40. It's going to vary from week to week. You know, I've always believed that balanced isn't a percentage-based thing. It's you've got to be a threat to throw and pass on every down, and that's what we want to get to. So I think we can get there. You know, I've watched pretty much every game from the last 2 years of the kids that we've got coming back, and there's some talent there. There's some ability. You know, we got to clean up a lot of fundamentals, and they're obviously going to have to learn the offense, which is going to take some time. But I think we'll be pretty diverse, and we'll be pretty dangerous on that side of the ball. You know, a defense, we're going to be very, very aggressive. It's going to be a complete switch from what we've run in the past. We're going to come after people, and we're going to stop the run at all costs. You know, that's going to be our philosophy, and we're going to make teams pass to beat us. And, you know, I know there's some teams in our league that are capable of it, and we'll have to take a slightly different approach with those teams. But, you know, hopefully it'll be really windy those games, and that'll help us out a little bit too. So,
well, you mentioned Culver Stockton. That's when you would have first came in contact with Jay Carnegie, Lincoln native, on the coaching staff.
Yep.
You said Lincoln football has a potential to be a gold mine here.
Yes.
Explain that a little bit.
Like I said, I've seen the talent. I've seen that we've got good-sized kids. I know the JFL program here is very, very healthy and has won pretty consistently and has pretty good numbers. So you got a good feeder program in place, which I know a lot of coaches taking over a program in the situation that it is usually don't have that. Usually it's broken at the JFL level, and currently I don't believe that it is. So I think that there's a foundation that's in place, and I really think that, you know, with me coming from the outside, me, I'm different. You know, I'm from the South. You know, there's going to be times that I'm going to be saying stuff that people are going to look at me and like, what the heck did he just say? And sometimes they're literally going to say, what the heck did you just say with my accent? So, you know, that happens. That's all part of it. But I think that'll give a little bit of an energy to the area, you know, and it's, I think, like I said earlier, you know, change is uncomfortable for a lot of people, but it also kind of excites them a little bit too. Yeah. So I think that's going to be a big thing. And, you know, watching Rochester do what they've done in this league for the last few years and to the 4A level in the playoffs the last 5 years, I generally believe we can get to that level long term. You know, they're the only other 4A school in our conference, so there's no reason we can't do the same thing that they've done.
So would you say, along those lines, what would be your biggest challenge coming in here?
Biggest challenge coming in here, you know, obviously is going to be the mentality. You know, that's one thing growing up as a Vanderbilt fan and being the different places that I've been, I've been able to see, you know, what the difference is. You know, Vanderbilt fans, Vanderbilt players over the years, the biggest thing, you know, when Coach Franklin came in there and did what he did a few years ago, He talked about having to change the mentality, change the fan base, raise the expectations, and have them looking beyond, well, you know, it's great if we can, you know, come close to making a bowl game. Same for us, you know, it's great if we can go 4-5 and almost make the playoffs. You know, we want to get to the point where in a few years that's not good enough anymore. You know, we want to be in the playoffs consistently. We want to be a perennial playoff contender. So we've got to raise those expectations. And, you know, I've been at winning programs and I've been at losing programs, and there's not much difference in what's done. There's not much difference in preparation. It really all comes down to attitude. So that's the thing that we're going to have to change. And unfortunately, that is the hardest thing to change. So it's going to take some time. And, you know, some guys are going to buy in right away when we talk to them this afternoon. Other guys, it's going to take a couple of weeks during the season. Some guys and some fans, it's going to take a year or two. So it's just we've got to be able to step back and look at the big picture and see what this program can be, but also keep the perspective that we can look at the small victories as we go along. You know, when you come in with an 18-game losing streak, yes, it's a great thing to win one game, but you can't be satisfied with that. You know, if we come out and knock off Southeast week one next year, I think that's who our opening opponent is. If we come out and knock them off week one next year, we can't celebrate and think that we just won the Super Bowl. You know, we got 8 games left, maybe more. So we've got to keep it in perspective and keep our eyes on the long-term prize.
You're you mentioned Rochester, mm-hmm. obviously. So let's go to the conference. You've watched the films. You know a little bit about our conference. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty good conference. Mm-hmm. There's been talk of us leaving the Central State 8. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you share in, or how do you feel about the conference we're in and how we can get and be competitive?
I think right now it's a very good thing for us. You know, I mentioned Rochester's run in the playoffs, and you know, that's come a lot from their coaching and everything, but it's also come from the challenges they see week to week in the Central State 8. You know, they go in and they're arguably more prepared for the playoffs than the other teams that they're going to face. And I think that's really led to their success. And I think if we get to the point that we want to be at, that's going to be very good for us as well. Now, that being said, long term, if the enrollments continue to separate, you know, I know there's a few 6A teams now because the enrollment's gone up. In our conference, if basically everybody besides us in Rochester end up at 6A or even 7A, you know, that's something that, you know, long term we may have to look at shifting, but that's down the road. I think short term, it's where we need to be. All of our other sports have proven they can compete in it, so there's no reason that we can't either. We've got the size. We may not be the fastest team, but we have had some speed over the years. So, I mean, year to year, I think we've got as good a chance as anybody else.
Well, you got like the positive attitude you have coming in here. Yep. So where do you see Lincoln football going in the future? What's your plans?
I generally think that we can be a perennial playoff contender here. You know, long term, I would love for us to be a state championship contender. And, you know, when I go and talk with the staff today and talk with the players today, that's what I'm going to talk to them about. You know, everything from here on out is going to be with the goal in mind of raising the trophy in Champaign or DeKalb or wherever the championship game happens to be that year. And that may take 5 years, it may take 10 years, it may take 15 years, I don't know. But, you know, getting back to looking at the small incremental goals along the way, if we can get to the playoffs, then the expectation becomes that we're going to get to the playoffs regularly. Then it's going to become advancing in the playoffs, and then we can take it step by step. You know, we're going to take that all the way down to the smallest level. You know, when we talk to the team for preparation and everything, next year, we're not going to talk about the 2015 season. We're going to talk about it week to week. Right now, it's Southeast season, and that's all we're looking forward to. We're not looking at week two or three or anything beyond that. The only exception to that would be Lanphier. You know, it's a rivalry game for us, so we're going to say, yeah, it's Southeast season, and it's going to be, you know, 8 weeks to Lanphier. So that's where we're always going to keep that in the back of our mind, that Lanphier's coming up.
So you want to build that rivalry with Lanphier?
Absolutely. That's kind of a two-part thing. I know Lanphier is a big rivalry for us in basketball, so we want to take that over to the football program as well. You know, we already kind of mentioned the Vanderbilt love and the hatred of orange and that type of thing already kind of being ingrained in me. So, you know, that's
Jim snuck that in on you.
I know.
So he loves Jay Cutler, huh? And you hate Peyton Manning.
I don't hate Peyton Manning. I have respect for Peyton Manning. I genuinely disliked him early part of his career, but you know, I've got some respect for him a little bit. But that's, you know, we're going to carry that rivalry over from basketball, and you know, it's going to be natural for me to hate orange. And I also think too, long term, with that, you know, being said, and with Rochester being the only 4A team in our league, and them sharing that hated color too, you know, I think long term, if we get to the point where we're playing them twice a year, once in the regular season, once in the playoffs, that's going to develop into something too.
So, yeah, that'd be pretty fun.
Yep,
you get that going on.
Yeah.
Jumping through things now, tell us a little bit about what do you want from the fans and the supporters of Lincoln football? What changes you want them to make?
You know, I want them to believe in what we're doing. I want them to, you know, like I said, take a step back and see the progress that we're going to be making. We're not going to come in and go 14-0 next year. It's the odds of that happening are pretty slim.
If you do, would you stay or would you take a job somewhere else?
Okay. I'd stay.
So he would. He wouldn't have to pay for another meal in this town.
I was going
to
say that's be pretty respected there. But you know, if we do that, great. But you know, we need to have the realistic goals. And like I said, that's what part of that mentality of looking at it's just Southeast season right now. We're going to throw everything we've got at Southeast, and then it'll be, I think Glenwood's next. So it'll be Glenwood season and so on and so forth. So we'll take that approach with everything. We obviously want them to show up to games. You know, we want them to be loud at games. We need to develop a really tremendous home field advantage. I know that's a big part of the basketball success. I know Coach Alexander speaks about that on a regular basis. So, you know, we need Railer Nation to make a lot of noise against our opponents. We play on a lot of no-huddle teams. We need to disrupt that communication. We need to get behind our defense on third down or fourth down situations, those type of things. Or a big thing, a big mentality that we're going to have is going to be raise L. You know, that's the letter L, not the place below the ground, but you know, raise L. So on our kick,
I got it.
Yeah,
how slow you
after
are.
He explained it.
Yeah, on our kickoffs, everybody on our sideline is going to have our L's with our fingers up in the air, and we'd like that from the fans, just kind of showing their belief and everything like that. And it's all going to come down to belief. You know, right. Hopefully they're making noise with it if they want to be one of those that sits in the seats and. Tells the person in front of them to sit down, you know, that's fine. At least they're there believing, you know, so I'll take that. So, but that's the biggest thing.
Well, and that's what do you want our fans to experience at a game? What's the excitement?
I want some excitement. You know, that's one thing that stuck out with me watching all those games. You know, I watched them on your broadcast on the YouTube channel, and that was, you know, all I can hear is you guys. You can't hear the fans a whole lot. You can hear the band occasionally, but, you know, they've got to get into it. And I realize part of that comes from the losing the last few years, but when we get some energy going and when they see the progress that we're starting to make, you know, they can really help us out creating an atmosphere. So, and that's going to help our team a great deal. Our kids are going to get behind that, and they're going to realize that other people are believing. And it comes back to what I said earlier. If everybody's going to start believing and buying in at different times, and the more noise we can get and the better atmosphere we can get, we're going to get more fans bought in. We're going to get more of our players bought in, more of our coaches bought in, and the youth players are going to be involved. They're going to be at all of our games. So it's going to get them bought in long term, and they're going to start growing up about being a Lincoln football player, or at least a Lincoln athlete.
And it looks like Sam already hooked you up with some gear.
Yeah, he got some green and red last night.
That's nice. Got that on. Can we?
Oh yeah, you don't have one of those.
Oh no, I don't. They don't give me anything. No. Hello, Sam. Kidding. I got plenty. Hey, let's jump into your personal life a little bit. Tell us about, you know, married, kids, all that stuff. Tell
married,
fans.
Married, no kids. I got a wonderful wife, Bridget. She's excited to be moving up here. She's actually from Jacksonville originally, so we'll be a little bit closer to her family. We do hate leaving Herman. Herman's been an awesome place for us just in the few months that we've been there. Great people, great community, great school, great kids at the school, but you know, this is it's too good of an opportunity to pass up. And like I said earlier, I genuinely believe this is where God wants me in the next chapter of our lives. So we're excited about that. So no real plans for kids. It's one of those things that, you know, my kids in class and my kids on the team, they're kind of my kids. And, you know, I love them to death. But, you know, there's some days that, you know, you enjoy leaving them at the end of practice. So it's one of those things. So it's.
I think we could all say that. It's kind of nice.
It's everybody knows that. So.
You got anything?
Not really.
I thought you were sitting there bubbling with one.
Nah, I'm just thinking.
Well, I tell you what, you know, we'd like to welcome you to town, and I think you know the fans will get out there and support you,
right.
And we'll get these kids out. And
one thing I do have a question: how do you right now? I mean, we do have what 37 kids out for football last year through the whole program. How do you get the numbers up? I know it's going to take some time. You know, nobody expects you to come in and have 90 kids come out for football next year, which would be great.
Right.
But how do you keep? Because I know I've been involved with youth football for probably 10 years,
right.
We always, the younger kids, our numbers are phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
And as they get older, you know, 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th, they dwindle. You're lucky right. to have 14 kids on a team.
Right.
How do you keep, or how do you get these kids interested? Because it's a different type of kid these days.
Yes.
There's a lot of lazy kids out there that rather sit home, play Xbox,
yeah.
and then get out and, you know, actually work and play a sport.
Right.
How do you get those kids excited about playing regular football? How do you get those numbers up?
There's a few different ways we'll do that. You know, initially, we obviously need some high school age kids, so we'll be shaking all the trees we can in the high school. I think with the coaching change, usually anytime there's a coaching change, you bring out about 10 to 20 more kids just off of that anytime that happens. So I really think that that'll happen just kind of on its own a little bit. The big thing is we've got to, it all starts with retention. You know, those 37 or 40 or however many kids show up today at our 3:30 meeting, you know, they've got to buy in and they've got to really believe that we're going to be heading in a positive direction. And then they're going to go out and, you know, text and tweet and Facebook all their friends and tell them all the great things that are going to be happening, and hopefully they'll bring back some kids that have quit in the past, the kids that maybe miss football a little bit and would love to come back and regret quitting, because now, you know, they're not behind the curve anymore. Everything's changing. Special teams is changing. Defensive scheme is changing. Offensive scheme is changing. They're not behind the curve. They're going to be coming in right at the same level of knowledge, basically, as the kids that have played the last few years. So now's the time to jump back in the pool. Long term, you know, we're going to get the JFL very involved. We're going to have them at all our home games, you know, basically kind of making a little tunnel or walkway, you know, giving us five as we walk out onto the field. Mm-hmm. Again, kind of trying to build that dream a little bit. And then we'll be there on Saturdays and Sundays for their games, you know, trying to return the favor. We'll have our players out there in their jerseys and, you know, giving them five and you know, congratulating them on their big moments. And that's going to foster a real big thing between them and really build the relationship there. We're going to really kind of focus on the actual name of the school. We're going to call ourselves a lot more of Lincoln Community and try and encompass the mentality that we're all, you know, one big football program. We're all one big football family. So I really think that'll build us. And then, you know, you talked about kids getting older, and it's a battle that every coach is facing right now across the country. There's a lot of guys that are going the sports specialization route. You know, they get talked right. to about AAU programs and traveling programs and all that stuff. And we'll fight that battle, because it's not, you know, sports specialization. There's more and more statistics coming out seemingly every day talking about really the dangers of it. You know, it's actually worse for you than the benefits, because you can get overuse injuries because you're doing the same motions all the time, you're getting the same mechanics all the time. A lot of scholarships are going more to multi-sport athletes, especially at the higher levels. So that's something that we will we'll make sure that we address. And you know, it's winning programs are going to be winning programs regardless of whether you're playing the same sport year round. And that same coach that's you know, winning at the high school level with a high school program, you know, you're winning because of that coach. You're not winning because you had an AAU coach that maybe played for 4 years or something like that. So you're usually not learning the same thing. There are exceptions, but for the most part, that's not the negatives outweigh the positives in that. So we'll address that. We'll educate people on that. And you know, at the end of the day, if they want to do it, they're going to do it. But
exactly, and that's one thing I was kind of wanting to touch on. There's been the rumor has it that, you know, coaches tell these kids that, you know, I don't want you playing this sport, you need to stick to one sport. That is so far from the truth that
yeah.
it's not even funny.
Absolutely.
And I can't even, what's a good I don't know. See, I gotta watch what I gotta
Loins.
Watch what I say, because these guys tape everything, and if you say a wrong thing,
yeah.
you're gonna hear about it for months and months.
Have you ever said something wrong?
Oh yeah, I have, and they let you know. So
just don't forget he played Rocky Top earlier.
I know. So I guess
never
what I'm
will
getting
like
at
him,
is
will
you know. Yeah, Jim, you didn't start it off real well with
blacklisted
this.
Already.
Yeah, see. New subject. But yeah, as far as, you know, coaches telling kids, I don't want you playing that sport, that's so far from the truth.
Absolutely.
And you know, I'm with you. Play all three sports.
Yeah.
You know, because you have to have your athletes out there.
Yep. You're learning new skills. Yeah, you're competing. Yeah,
exactly.
I mean, that's what
if you're
need.
An athlete, let's play it, you know. But, you know, that makes me mad.
Get out and have fun, because you've only got 4 years of high
exactly.
school.
Yeah.
I mean, you may have had five, Scott, but
I only had
kids
four.
Are going to get
no.
four.
Well, actually three. They wanted me out, so...
And we're going to talk about that today in our staff meeting and in our player meeting especially. No, I want all of our football players playing more sports. I want they can go up, play basketball, play baseball, play run track. Mm-hmm. You know, play golf. Well, golf's probably in the fall.
Yeah,
but
we don't need that.
Some sort of spring sport.
Because if they're not involved in sports, anything,
exactly,
what are they going to be doing?
They're sitting around playing Xbox, eating Cheetos. Yeah.
Ho-hos, Joe.
Looking at me for.
But
hey, throw your time out again there for the kids, for the players that you want to meet. Maybe for some of my parents who are listening and they don't know.
Player, parent, any community member that wants to come out, we'll be meeting at 3:30 today at the high school auditorium. I'd be glad to have anybody out there that wants to, even if you are only thinking about playing football for about 1%, you know, come out and we'll see if we can raise that percentage a little bit. So just come out and hear what we got to say and you can make your own decision.
Absolutely. And the get out there. And that's in the cafeteria?
The auditorium.
Oh, in the auditorium. Yeah.
Why would it be in the cafeteria?
I was going to say, isn't there the tournament going on? Where are they going to? The auditorium.
Well, you don't play basketball in the auditorium.
No, but they eat food in the cafeteria where they have all the stuff going on.
All right. That's why it's in the auditorium. See,
it's a constant argument up here. All right. Hey, what's that music mean? You're shutting us off?
He's
never
done that.
Is this like the Grammys? Did I win an award?
He's never done that.
Who do I thank?
That's good, Jim. Jim, that's good. That's real good. I'm going to pile up. We're going to all go scoop our driveways and dump it on his driveway. So
I know a guy with a dump truck.
Well, Seth, thanks for coming in with us this morning.
Thank you.
A lot of exciting things happening for the Lincoln High School football program, and it's very refreshing, you know, to hear a younger kid come in. Or gentleman, I shouldn't say kid. You're not
That's
a
fine.
Kid, but you know, it's very exciting, and you know, hopefully, you know, the kids come out, support you, and you know, this is even the community, and I know they will. We always have pretty good crowds. They're just sitting there watching, though. They don't get really fired up, but yeah. I see that changing, and we look forward to having you on each Saturday morning, and then you know, when season starts, we'll get you in here, and you know, we'll be able to tell you know a little bit more about your philosophy and you know how you go about things, and you know everything's new right now. I know a lot of people have questions. You probably get bombarded with questions today that
That's
you've
fine.
Never even expected.
That's what
and
we want.
So you know it's a good thing, and I'm pretty excited. You excited?
Yep.
Joe,
absolutely. You gonna you got anybody back home listening we'll give a shout out to? Anybody on that internet listening to us worldwide?
I don't know. My parents are probably listening somewhere, so I'll say hello
shout.
To them. My wife's in Kansas City. I don't know if she's listening or not, so but I'll tell her I love her.
She can always go back online and watch it, too.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
We'll give you all that information.
She'll critique me. She'll be like, you shouldn't have said that, or it's all right.
I think the first thing she'll say are, who are those two other guys on there?
Yeah. What do they contribute? Nothing. So
anybody that did listen is going to say the same thing I did about Rocky Talk. They're going to think that's hilarious.
Oh, I didn't know Jim. Jim did some research or something. I don't know. He's
Joe
very,
Frazier. He
he's
jabbed.
Very clever. He's very sneaky and
Frazier.
Clever. So, all right, Seth, good luck on your upcoming adventures. I'm sure you'll have football camps, all kinds of stuff going on.
Yep.
And, you know, we'll be a source of that information as well here on 96.3. All right, that's going to do it for us, Joe. Man, that was
gonna
a good
wrap
show
it up.
Right there. Whenever we don't have to do the talking, it's very good.
Absolutely. So, I think our listeners feel the same way.
And there's Mr. Parrott.
Local city councilman.
Yes, congratulations.
Councilman Parrott.
Councilman Parrott.
All right. Ex-Lincoln football coach.
Yeah.
That it?
That's it. All right.
All right. Hey, thanks for listening.
Yeah.
You want me to say that thing Jake always does?
Well, we got to get to where we're going to be next week. And we never
you
know.
You going to sing the song?
No. We're going to be at Jake's Furnishings next week. And as far as guests, we don't really know yet. Right now, we have Carol Catholic slated. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Guest getter?
Carol Catholic. The
depending on how the tournament goes next week, when they have to play. So we'll plan on having them in next Saturday at Jake's Furnishings. As always, thanks to the Lincoln Hampton Inn for
the coffee and treats.
Bucket full of goodies, coffee, pastries, whatever else they throw in that box. It's very delicious. And
speaking of changes, those are making some changes to your body.
It's going to do it for us today here at... Where are we at?
Joe Ryan Country Financial.
Yes, always come in for free quotes. We don't really know his hours because I don't know if he's ever here.
I'm here except when I'm not.
And that's pretty much all the time.
There you go.
All right, thanks for listening. That's been the Cheap Seats here on 96.3 FM.
Good day.